Gracious God, may the thoughts that you've placed on my heart be the right words for your people this morning. So I've never really considered myself to be handsome or good looking. I don't think I'm especially smart or perceptive. So why would someone be attracted to me or be willing to take what I say to heart? It's probably not because of my physical abilities or my mental acuity. According to one survey, 99% of women and 94% of men would change something about their appearance if they could. I'm in that group. If there was something I could easily do about it, I'd have hair on the top of my head and would remove several inches from my waist. If you consider the general population for very long, you'll soon notice that not many women are candidates for the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue, and not many men are candidates to be on the cover of the Gentleman's Quarterly. And Abraham Lincoln, who by no measure was much of a looker, is reported to have said much the same thing. He said, "The Lord prefers common-looking people. That's the reason he makes so many of them." Most of us are in that position when we consider beauty. My father, who's up here, and my father-in-law, also up here, were both okay people, just common men. But when it came to raising their family, they used all of their power and all of their authority to make sure that their children knew that they loved them and that they were there for them whenever they were needed. So today is the third Sunday in a row where our Old Testament reading has taken us to an incident in the life of the prophet Samuel. In our reading this morning, following God's rejection of Saul, who was Israel's first king, Samuel is told to go to Bethlehem to anoint a new king, one of the sons of a man named Jesse. Jesse had 8 sons, however, and God doesn't tell Samuel in advance which one was to be selected. So Samuel goes to Bethlehem, where he announces a sacrificial ceremony and invites the unsuspecting Jesse and his sons to attend. Once they get there, each of the sons comes before Samuel in order of age, from eldest to youngest. The first is Eli. He's tall and movie star handsome, if they had movies back then. Seeing this hunk, Samuel thinks to himself, "Surely this is the Lord's anointed." But God tells Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." As the story proceeds, it turns out that the one God has chosen to be Israel's next king is Jesse's youngest son, David, who is also described as handsome. But by the time we learn that, we also know that David's looks are not what makes him God's choice. God is looking at what's in David's . The story shows us just one way that God is different from us. He's not fooled by personal appearances. He's not misled by beauty. Sometimes we are. There has been some research about how our attitudes toward and assumptions about people are often shaped by how they look. For example, these studies show mothers of attractive babies hold, cuddle, and kiss them more than mothers of unattractive babies. In one case, the researchers found a 4-year-old boy whose nose, part of the cheek and one ear, had been bitten off in a dog attack. When that happened, the child's parents began to behave differently toward him. They didn't hug him or touch him as much as before, and seldom smiled at him. Adults tend to rate more serious transgressions of attractive children as temporary departures, whereas they rate the same transgressions in unattractive children as basic behavior flaws. Teachers tend to give more attention and consideration to good-looking students and assume that they are of higher intelligence. Adults tend to assume that handsome people are sexually warmer, more interesting, more sociable, and more sincere. And good-looking female employees often earn between 8 and 20% more than average-looking female employees. Beware, though, that sometimes this works in the other direction as well, in that very beautiful people are often assumed to be unfeeling or stuck on themselves. Those beautiful people sometimes have trouble being taken seriously. So we're all glad that God looks deeper than our appearance when he's looking at us. In our gospel reading this morning, Jesus is making a point about size in the parable about the sowing of the seeds, both the wheat seeds and the mustard seed. If you've ever seen a kernel of wheat, you recognize that it's really small, less than an eighth of an inch in diameter. Yet when planted, cultivated, and harvested, that very small seed yields a tremendous amount of grain, which has been the staple of our diets from before Jesus' time, even into today. And a mustard seed is even smaller than that kernel of wheat. It would take about 100 to 150 mustard seeds placed end to end to make up an inch. In the parable, Jesus explains that the mustard seed, when it sprouts and grows, becomes a shrub with branches so large that the birds nest and take cover in its shade. Now, I've never seen a mustard plant that big, but I've seen plenty of mustard seed plants in my garden which have choked out the vegetables that I planted from just a very few of their very tiny seeds. Jesus' point in the two parables is that even the tiniest seeds have the potential to grow and become great things. He's asking people to consider that the kingdom of God got here from small beginnings and grew without any help from humans. So today's text invites us to learn a few things. One of them is to be aware of our natural tendency to be biased towards people one way or another based on their looks. An even further point is that trying to avoid this bias is not just smart behavior. It is a religious matter. As we're trying to be followers of Jesus, we ought to work at looking past a person's physical size and appearance and look in the heart. The text also invites us to learn a different meaning of beauty, saying that God looked at David's heart and found him worthy to be the next king is a way of saying that even though David was a good-looking man, his real beauty was in the size of his heart. The Navajo used the word beauty to designate the beneficial alliance between spirits and nature. While traditional Navajo faith is not Christian, Christianity can understand that way of using the word. You see, Jesus told those parables to explain that even a little faith can go a long way. That in his way of saying, that was his way of saying, that people should reflect God's righteousness and beauty in the little things that they do. Christianity has a form of the word beauty and is used in much the same way. The root word for beauty is also the root for the word beatitude. The Beatitudes are statements of Jesus that begin with, "Blessed are those," and go on to talk about states of spirituality. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. So we can see that in God's eyes, there is true beauty, especially in the spiritual state of a humble person who is sincerely seeking righteousness. We're all glad that God sees who we are on the inside and is not fooled by our outward appearance. We don't know why God made some of us better looking than others, or why he made us so that we're able to prefer certain physical attributes over others. But it raises our confidence in the moral nature of God to know that when God looks at each of us, he sees what's inside. He sees our heart and is not misled by our appearances. On Father's Day, we recognize our fathers and our mothers and all other people for the real beauty they show in loving God, loving neighbor, and loving us with the size of their hearts. Sure, they're not candidates for Miss America competition or a Hunkamania review. That's the good news. But it's also good news for those who are. For it's only at the heart level where an extreme makeover is really possible. And with God, real beauty is what counts. And in the case of that kind of makeover, we aren't expected to be able to do it by ourselves. Instead, God calls us to trust him to make us new, beautiful, and new. That's what Paul is writing about in 2 Corinthians 5:17. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Paul says, with faith as tiny as a mustard seed, we will grow to become new and beautiful in God's eyes. And God's eyes are the only ones we need to be concerned with.